case where the gauge book is U1, then the gauge book will be U1. And pi 1 of M3 will be ZB. What is this? So what these are, rho essentially is a map, is a function. Diagonalize this element and consider only the Karman. For the case of U1, of course, we don't even have to do that. U1 already is a leader. So, what this means in the case of U1, pi 1 equals ZB, you have X, which is an element U1, and because it's a map from pi 1, it should have a property X to the P equals 1. So there's a P possible choices. Okay. So now what is going on this side? What does it mean to pick a boundary condition? So from the work of this 3D correspondence, one knows that a flat connection on M3 is in one-to-one correspondence with the space of the vacua. So these are corresponding to vacua of T of M3. So these are also labeled by rho. Now, if you consider this setup and put the two-dimensional theory on torus, what you are getting is you have M4 with a boundary M3, and that corresponds to a torus. Doesn't correspond to a torus. It associates to it a torus on which, on the boundary of which, lives this TM2, and in the bulk lives, so this is a solid torus, and in the bulk lives T of M2. So from this point of view, you can see that this rho is associating, as I said, it's a part of the Hilbert space. So what that means is that TM3 is not a theory but a part of the Hilbert space of T of M3, or labeled T of M2 is labeled by state on of T of M2. And partition function that one computes of the P of M2 here is not quite a partition function, but it's a partition vector. It's the same type of phenomenon that Jonathan was talking about. He was talking about 6 dimensions and a 7 dimensional ambient areas. Okay, is there any question so far? Let's see, what we have here. So from this point of view, so, you know, in the case of Wafa-Witten partition function, that it was computed in a compact manifold, we expected the modularity of this partition function from the torus. But in this case, torus is a boundary of a solid torus. So how do I expect, you know, what is the expectation of the associated partition function of the T of M2 4 with some boundary condition rho. This is a function of q, and this should be character of a module associated to T of M4 chiral algebra. So instead of talking about functions, partial functions, we are talking about partial vectors now. Moreover, that vector has a nice action of SL to Z on it. When you act SL to Z on one of these characters, it will in general result in sum of all the characters. So perhaps an example would be illuminating. Now let us consider M4 to be O minus P bundle over C1. For us, the complex structure is not going to be important, so just think of it as a disk bundle over S2. So you have an S2, and at each point you have a disk. So disk has a circular boundary, and you can describe this space as how the circle goes around as you go around S2. And you know how the circle bundles on S2 are classified. They are classified by an integer p, which is essentially the chunk class, the first chunk class of this U1 bundle. You can think of it as the bundle of the gauge field when there is a monopole at the center of the system. So you can denote this space with point and with a label minus one. Because it's just, I'm just speaking. This S2 essentially is part of the second morphology, and what I'm drawing here is the intersection form of the second morphology. Okay, so in this case, what is the boundary? Boundary is, as I described earlier, simply the length space is P1 to P. I1 of the boundary is equal to now the choices of flat connections here essentially are determined by the solution to this equation x to the p equals 1, which are essentially maps from π1 into U1, and from the 3D correspondence, you can see that the T of M3, the theory corresponding to this T manifold, is simply the U1 Chern-Simons theory at level minus. One way is to compact twice on S1 to get the 2,2 theory with some twisted superpotential, which looks like the gauge field becomes a scalar field, a twisted chiral field, and this is the twisted superpotential that governs the next dynamics. And then the vacua are labeled by e to the dw to the by d log x equals 1, and this is simply the equation x to the p equals 1. Okay. So you can see that the vacua of this theory are indeed labeled by the same, which is how the boundary conditions of the wall occupancy are also defined. So now the scenario we have is that we have a torus, a solid torus, inside lives the Chern-Seppel theory, and outside lives the two-dimensional zero theory. So, of course, it's somewhat difficult to exactly identify what this theory is just from this data, but it helps to consider the weak version of the correspondence where you are half twisting here to correspond to get only a chiral algebra. So what I was going to say is that even though this theory is n equal to supersymmetric, if the space on which you put it is of the type sigma times R, you can still use the U1 symmetry to twist it and obtain a topology of the theory. Just from the manifold of this type. And this space here is a manifold of that type, namely it's a T2 times R. And the theory living here is U1 Chern-Seppel theory. And if you do the twist that I just said on the three manifold, on the three-dimensional theory, this TfM3, the twist associated to TfM2 essentially is the half twist, which gets rid of this and gives you only the chiral degrees of freedom on the boundary. Well, after the twist, it does become the pure Chern-Seppel. It's any good pure Chern-Seppel. In general, for any equal to so this is a very familiar phenomenon that on the boundary of a Chern-Seppel theory you have chiral degrees of freedom. And in this case, because it's U1 level B Chern-Seppel theory, the anomaly matching tells you that the 2D chiral theory should be the theory of U1P, a chiral WZW model. Compact boson or perturbed radius. And this symmetry has various representations. Just like the usual U1 has a representation, namely of char 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. This symmetry also has various representations, but they truncate. For example, the representation starts from 0 charge, 1 charge, and so on till p minus 1. And the higher charge states end up being equal to 0, 1. So you measure charge only more than the
p. So the p here is the limit of the cutting.
Yeah.
Yeah, so low here is the reason line.
Yes,
the reason line is only along one of the two dimensions.
No, so the reason line, so from that point of view, so associated to this, there is the picture of the nine modes also. Right?
In this case, you have this M4. It's a boundary.
And rho, in this picture,
is some Wilson line
that is Debye flat connection on the boundary. And in order to obtain the corresponding choice, in this case, what you need to do is to turn on Wilson line of appropriate the same representation at the core of the solid torus, and that induces precisely the same exactly the representation that we want on the direct representation model on the boundary of the torus. So this was explained by Moore and Seibel. Just look at Jensheimer's theory. It's not a gauge invariant theory if you have a boundary. And in order to make it gauge invariant, you need to introduce this chiral degrees of freedom on the boundary, which essentially give you this chiral observable model of U1 and W2. And if you want to get various representations of that, what you need to do is to quantize the theory on a disk, a manifold boundary, but with a Wilson line turned on. Then that reduces precisely the representations of the algebra that you want. So what that means for us is that So this leads to a prediction that if you do a U1 Chalasana theory, sorry, U1 Wapakita theory, the discussion so far, that this setup on the geometric side corresponds to this setup on the physical side. And over here, computing the partition function, meaning essentially taking the trace over this representation, computes for you the character, rho, as a function of Q of this chiral observable model, which is the theta function, some lattice theta, some theta function. Have the property that as P goes, as you take a rho to P, you can absorb it in here to make it zero again. So this is just a function. You put it very explicitly because it's U1. And then what for the Wapakita partition function, this is what you should get on this side. And indeed, if you calculate the Wapakita partition function, because the gauge group is U1, these string terms that are contributing are just point like string terms. This computation becomes very easy. Simply, they symmetric products on the space. And you can do this, and you get the same answer. Now you can try to generalize and consider more interesting four manifolds, precisely because we are interested in the question of classifying four manifolds. Of course, we are very far from it, but nevertheless, you would like to work towards it. Such four manifolds, you can start cutting and gluing and construct a large set of four manifolds, what is known as the plumbing four manifolds. The idea is, let's consider this object with 10 plus Q, let's say. And look at a patch here and a patch here. Now, because you are looking at a particular patch on S2, the base looks like a disk, D2, on which you also have a D2 fiber. Just this patch looks like D2 times D2. And this patch also looks like D2 times D2. And now you group these patches together, but identify base to the fiber and the fiber to the base. Okay. So that's probably slightly difficult to imagine what is going on. It's easy to draw. One less dimension, you consider a line fiber on S1, one less dimension. So we have this, and you consider another line fiber over S1. Of course, you don't have these non-trivial labels anymore, but just for the sake of analogy, let me draw this, and you consider a patch. So what is happening at the level of homology is that we are generating intersection form. So we have started with a sphere with just an intersection number minus p and minus q, and they intersect like so. And then you can go crazy with this construction and glue a bunch of spheres to each other and start generating graphs of this type with various labels and so on. And this class of four manifolds, or plumbing four manifolds, so far goes through in the same way for this class of four manifolds. And what you get, so let me just state the answer. What you get, so let's say there are R elements in this graph. You want the R chiral W model with the level given by the matrix associated to the intersection form. Or less fancy of saying this is that you simply get bosons, compact bosons associated to this lattice. And over here also, you could ask, what are the boundary conditions labeled by? So with this, this is an intersection form, so you can associate some lattice also to it. And in this lattice, you can also construct self-dual lattice. The dual lattice. And the boundary conditions essentially lie in this quotient. Let me start with the lambda. this chiral algebra, the representation theory of this chiral algebra is also labeled by such objects. So you can compute a character of a given representation which lies in this and match it with the Buffer-Witten partition function on this crazy manifold. And because it's U1, you can again do this computation explicitly and you see that it did the match. Non-trivial exercise would be to consider non-abelian groups. And in certain cases, you can say a few things about non-abelian theories as well. But let me point out that even though from physics point of view, the abelian case is seemingly not so interesting, the math point of view, it could be interesting. One cannot quite rule out the fact that, I mean, one cannot quite rule out that this might be useful from the point of view of smooth structure and so on. But I'm not quite sure that considering U1 case is sufficient, whether that will be, that will allow us to distinguish this non-trivial smooth structure. But nevertheless, let me say a few words on non-abelian cases. So when the 4 manifold M4 is a AD space, so meaning you start with R2, R4, and divide it with an orbital force of divided by some discrete group, which is a subgroup of SU2, labeled by ADE, it's just an AD orbital force, and you resolve this. And in this way, you can get M4. By resolve this, I mean you just blow up the spheres that are inside this manifold. And if you want to plot such a diagram for this, it is simply a chain of minus twos, like so. And they form the leafy diagram of ADE. In this case, Nakajima has studied Buffer-Witten partition function on the ADE space. And as I had stressed earlier, the boundary conditions are labeled by G. I mean, so I should say that the boundary of this, the pi 1 of the boundary of this C2 not gamma is all the ALE space. Is also just what the name is also a P type, is also Z. So in the non-abelian case you would get flat connections in boundary conditions are G belonging to UM. Now my gauge group is UM such that G to the P equals 1, modulo conjugation. And you know how to do this as well, because you are considering things modulo conjugation, you can diagonalize the